How's everybody doing tonight? Doing all right? Well, welcome to UW Marathon County, or as we call it, Dave Obey's alma mater. I first met Dave Obey 20 years ago when I came up here from Chicago to become the news director and anchorman at Channel 7. And I had a chance to interview Mr. Obey live on television. And I thought, well, I'm going to show this gentleman that I'm not somebody to be trifled with. And I asked him a question, a tough question. I thought it was a fair question, but it was probably kind of a gotcha question. And Mr. Obey looked at me and he blinked twice. And then he said, "With all due respect." Now, when Mr. Obey says, "With all due respect," it means you need to put on your flak jacket. And he said, "Mr. Moberg, that was without a doubt the most idiotic, ridiculous thing I have ever heard from somebody who purports to be a member of your profession." So I gained a lot of respect for Dave Obey right then and there. I think he gained some respect for me over the years too, but I had to earn it. I first met Peter Yarrow tonight in person, but I feel like I've known him for a long time. This record album, this is the very first record album I owned. I was 11 years old when my mother bought it for me. It was like 1962 or 63, before the Beatles. And if you're old enough, you can remember back to the kind of pablum that was on top 40 radio at the time. And this was so much different. Three authentic voices singing in harmony with acoustic guitars, real music, talking about real things and politics and social change and the civil rights struggle of our time. They did two songs on here by Pete Seeger, who was blacklisted at the time. Later, singing before thousands of people at the great civil rights marches during the 60s. And as I found out tonight, I had Peter Yarrow and Dave Obey on my radio show, on the Route 51 show, and Peter hasn't changed. He is still fighting the good fight. He is still fighting the struggle. And he is still taking his music to a place where he believes that music is something that can bring people together, bridge differences, expand individual consciousness, and expand the consciousness of society, and in the process, create real social change. So ladies and gentlemen, please welcome the legendary Congressman Dave Obey and the legendary musician Peter Yarrow. Thank you so much.
For me to be here to perform for you and to perform with one of my heroes, one of those people that just stuck up for principle for the 42 years that he was in office, and who's we hope there will be more of them, but they are a rare breed in Congress, certainly. This is a song really about people like David Obey, who had a moral core that was so strong that they did bet on or subscribe to what they really cared about. And this song, by inference, is about that, but it's actually about somebody who fails to bet on a horse that he loves. It's a magical horse. His bridle is silver, his mane it is gold, and the worth of his saddle has never been told. and his name is Stewball. And in the story, it's a sad, sad thing. When the person narrating the story says, "I bet on the gray mare, I bet on the bay, but if I and if I bet on old Stewball, I'd be a free man today." Here I was teaching in a third grade class that connected arts and the growth, the emotional, social, and intellectual growth of children program, Guggenheim, learning through art. And ask the children a question which you as adults, and a good many of you are adults in the audience, I saw you, you would not have an easy answer for this. But the kids, you know, who are still fresh and they haven't, don't have their blinders on or their masks on when they're that young, although it's, that's a challenge too. I said, what does that mean? What is that man saying when he says, "I bet on the gray mare, I bet on the bay, but if I bet on Stewball, I'd be a free man today"? And one of the kids said, "Well, that's," she said, I think that maybe he was a slave, and if he'd won, he would have bought his freedom." I thought that was extraordinary. I'd never heard that before. This was over a decade ago that this took place. Another one said, "Well, I think if he bet on Stewball, he would have bet on himself, what he believed in. He believed in Stewball, and he failed to do that. And if we bet on what we believe in, then we're free inside." I said, "I'm with you, kid." So that's what this song is about, and dedicated tonight to my friend, with whom I've allied my efforts over the years, and sometimes our music together in this song, in the key of F. And you're invited to sing along. When I tell you the words, it'll be easier. Stewball was a racehorse, and I wish he were mine. He never drank water, he always drank wine, and his bridle was silver, and his mane it was gold, and the worth of his saddle has never been told. Oh, the fairgrounds were crowded, oh, the fairgrounds were crowded. Stewball was there, Stewball was there. The betting was heavy, but the betting was heavy on the gray and the mare, on the gray and the mare. As they were approaching, as they were approaching, about halfway around, about halfway around, the gray mare she stumbled, gray mare she stumbled, fell to the ground, fell to the ground. And way out yonder, and way out yonder, ahead of them all, came a prancing and a dancing my noble Stewball, my noble Stewball, David Olley.
gray man. Lord, I bet on the bank. If I'd have bet on my stew ball, I'd be a free man. The wood owl she hollers, and the turtle dove she moans. I'm a poor boy in trouble, I'm a long way from home. Stewball was a racehorse, Stewball was a racehorse. Wish you were mine, wish you were mine. Never drank water, she always drank wine. And way out yonder, ahead of them all, ahead of them all, came a prancing and a dancing, a prancing and a dancing, my noble Stewball, noble Stewball. Stewball was a racehorse, Stewball was a racehorse. Lord, I wish you were mine. He never drank water, never drank water, always drank wine, he always drank wine. So now you know what the rest of the concert's going to be like. I know you walked in here saying, what is it? What? And there you have it. So I'm going to ask David to do a few thank yous here, because they are due. Rather than waiting until you're tired and not listening.
Well, I simply want to thank everybody for coming tonight, and to thank you all for your support for the center. And most of all, to thank Peter, because he embodies so much of the history that we have witnessed and felt and been a part of going back a lot of years. And it took a lot of sacrifice for him. He's going to Jordan tomorrow. He flew from New York here today. He's going to Jordan tomorrow.
That's not Jordan, Pennsylvania either.
Yeah, and he will tell you tonight about some of the things he's doing, including his anti-bullying campaign, which he's trying to push in schools. And Lord knows what some of the events that have happened in schools in this country lately, we very badly need that. But thanks again for coming. Eric asked me to remind people that if you, in the unlikely event you want to take a picture, there's no problem, so go ahead. Thank you all again for coming.
I'd like to also, yeah. I'd like to also encourage you to haul out those iPhones and make videos and post it on your Tweety Weedy or and sell it if you can, you know. It's too late to worry about that stuff no more. A good friend of both David's and mine is Tom Paxton, who's a wonderful songwriter. And we're going to do a song that he wrote that Mary used to sing, that she made iconic, really. It's a love song. So if you're sitting next to somebody, it's your sweetie. You can hold hands or put your arm around one another. Or if you're sitting next to somebody you're finding reasonably attractive. This is an opportunity. It's a lesson. Wait a second. I want to do this in another key. Lesson too late. Let's do it in. It's a lesson. Let's do it in G.
In G.
Yeah. I'll tell you, as long as I don't say F flat, he's going to be fine. Because there ain't no F flat.
It's always nice to know what you're going to play.
It's a lesson too late for the learning, made of sound, made of sound. In the wink of an eye, my soul is turning in your hand, in your hand. Are you going away with no word of farewell? Will there be none left behind? I could have loved you better, I didn't mean to be unkind. You know, that was the last thing on my mind. You got reason aplenty for going, this I know, this I know. And the weeds have been steadily growing. Please don't go, please don't go. You're going away with no word of farewell. There'd be no trace left behind. I could have loved you better, I didn't mean to be unkind. That was the last thing on my mind. As I lie in my bed in the morning without you, without you, each song in my heart dies a burning without you, without you. Are you going? With no word of farewell, will there be not a trace left behind? I could have loved you better, didn't mean to be unkind. You know, that was the last thing of my life. Now, I know that you folks don't like this kind of music. You got, and you don't like Peter, Paul, and Mary. That's too bad. Because you're going to get suffused in Peter, Paul, and Mary-dom all night.
People say, well, what are you doing now that Mary passed? I mean, well, Mary's not gone. She's no more gone than Joe Hill. I dreamt I saw Joe Hill last night, alive as you and me. Said, I'm a Joe, you're 10 years gone. He never died, said he, I never died, said he. The copper bosses killed you, Joe. They killed you, Joe, says I. Takes more than guns to kill a man, says Joe. I did not die, says Joe. I didn't die. So, Mary's not gone. She's her corporal self is gone, but she's still around giving you, women of a certain age who were then very, very young, permission
to be truthful. Permission to not be using your feminine wiles to get power. To speak truth to men and power. Mary had no alternative. Her mother said she had no editor between her heart and her mouth. Which posed some problems over the 50 years that we were together. But it also kept us together, because we were always truthful to each other. A remarkable person we're going to remember by singing together and playing the song that Mary made super iconic, which is Leaving on a Jet Plane. Key of E. And when we get to the chorus, for those of you who can distinguish between a verse and a chorus, you sing Mary's part, and I'll sing Peter's part, or Paul's part, whose real name was Noel, but that's another story. And then Mary will reappear. She's always in my voice when I sing. And this music will be in people's hearts and in our culture and in our lives. This music that we sang and we stood on the shoulders of the Woody Guthries and the Pete Seegers and the Weavers, the Burl Ives and the Josh Whites. And we just carried it on. Ours is a, like all folk singers, we get on that train, we add our voices, then we get off, and those voices are still there. And it's a great gift to know that the music will sustain. So you sing along now. You can also hold hands on this one if you like. Okay, your own hands, that's right. That's right. Onistic, you know, stimulation is good. Okay. All right. So Mary is with us now as we do this one. All my bags are packed. I'm ready to go. Standing here outside your door, I hate to wake you up to say goodbye, but the dawn is breaking, it's early morn. Taxi's waiting, he's blowing his horn. Already I'm so lonesome I could cry, so kiss me and smile. So kiss me and smile for me. Tell me that you'll wait for me. Hold me like you'll never let me go. I'm leaving. on a jet plane. Don't know when I'll be back again. Oh, babe, I hate to go. There's so many times I've let you down. So many times I've played around. I tell you now, they don't mean a thing. Every place I go, I'll think of you. Every song I'll sing for you. When I come back, I'll wear a wedding ring. Kiss me and smile for me. Tell me that you'll wait for me. Hold me like you'll never let me go. I'm leaving on a jet plane, sing. Now the time has come to leave you. One more time and let me kiss you. Close your eyes and I'll be on my way. And we'll dream about the days to come when I won't have to leave alone. About the times I won't have to say, kiss me and smile for me. Okay, here's the big question I'm going to ask David to respond to. I didn't tell him I was going to do this. Is singing like this a political act? And if so, why? And if not, why not?
That's the dumbest question I ever heard. How the hell do I know? I'm not in politics anymore. I don't have to answer those questions.
Well, you are in politics, and I maintain, notwithstanding anybody's opinion to the contrary, that when we unite our hearts, we don't have to be singing Blowing in the Wind or If I Had a Hammer, but if we just hear that sound, the sound that you just made, that is the sound of peace. That's the sound of community. And I maintain that that is the very guts, the very heart of what is so absent today in society, more and more absent, more and more gone, is that sense that we are connected, that we belong to each other, and that ultimately there are political ramifications to feeling apart or connected. And therefore, I've answered the dumbest question I've ever answered in rather astute fashion. But I'd like to call your attention to the fact that when we had our marches, that the music was in its own way not a relief from the message. It was part of the message. It was carrying the sense that if we stand together in common cause, that we will indeed, as we found out, be able to change the course of history. So now I'm going to ask you another dumb question. And don't give me a dumb answer either. What's more fun, picking or politicking?
It ain't even close.
Okay. So, well, you don't know what the answer is, do you? But that's because David plays his cards close to his chest. Who thinks that by answering that way, by saying it ain't even close, that he meant that politicking is more fun? Well, that is the dumbest hand. I think we all deserve to be on the dumb machine here. I got to say, just being able to experience what music is, it, you know, David's, you should tell them that, about your father. And his little bit of history that seeped into your life.
Well, people always ask me, how did you learn to play the harmonica? And I tell them that after World War II, my dad was in a harmonica band, kind of like the old Harmonicats, if some of you remember them. And he and two of his friends would go all around the Wisconsin River Valley. They would go to talent shows and they would play. And he was very, very good. And he taught me to play Silent Night as a Christmas present to my mother when I was about 9. And that's how I started. And then, as I told Glenn this afternoon, I was a screwed up kid for a while. Some people say I never outgrew it. But back in the 7th grade, I would skip school 2 days a week. My mother would push me on the school bus. We lived out on Highway 29. I'd get on the bus, I'd go into town. As soon as I got to school, I'd turn around, walk back, grab my dog, go into the woods. I built a little shelter house in the woods. And I'd sit there and I'd read, and I would play the harmonica, and that's how I learned to play the harmonica. It was more fun than school. And after a while, I straightened out. When the nuns started putting me in a debate on the issue of Joe McCarthy, that's when I thought, geez, there's something worth going to school for. So, so I did.
David Obey and I are the same age, and I too obviously grew up in the era of the blacklist, the witch hunting, And my mother used to tell me, don't answer the doorbell if I'm not there, because she was literally afraid, because she was a member of the Teachers Union and Planned Parenthood, that were considered by some to be, I kid you not, subversive organizations. That's how crazy it got. You think it's crazy now? It was crazy then. And it was one of the darkest periods in our history. And then, emerging out of it, there came this 1960s consciousness that questioned that a lot of the rules and regs. And the folk music itself carried that message. It was written mainly by anonymous songwriters. We'll never know who wrote some of these songs that we're going to do. And then there emerged, in the way that Pete Seeger was already writing song, somebody who took it to another level, Bobby Dylan. And all of a sudden, it gave permission to all of us to go and write our hearts. And this is one of the songs that had extraordinary relevance then. It's called The Times They Are Changing. And you think that this is just relevant then. I have to mention that I was down there with Tim TeChristopher, Bitter 70, who went into this auction of land that was put on sale by the Bureau of Land Management. It was in the last days of the new administration, and why giggleth thou? Forsooth. So it was a gift to the oil and gas folks, because it wasn't properly vetted, and these were pristine lands near Canyonlands and Arches National Park. And he was there, and he was picketing, Tim DeChristopher. And then he said, oh, well, I don't think this is getting us too far. Let me go inside and see what's going on. And he walked in, college student, nice looking, you know, well-spoken. And she said, are you here to bid? And he said, why, yes. And she gave him a paddle with a 70 on it. He sat down and he saw these lands going for $5 an acre or whatever. He started bidding on them. $1,800,000 later, he had a lot of land. He did not, however, have any money. So the government brought charges, and they said, we'll give you 30 days in jail. You plead guilty, and we'll forget about this. He said, no, I am not here to forget about this. I'm here to stop the collusion of moneyed interests who get elected and determine policy that will bring us to climate irreversible disaster. I am going to court. And they postponed the trial 11 times. And on the eve of his first trial, we had a concert. My daughter and her cellist and I in his church, Unitarian Church. And when I first suggested this singing vigil, they said, why do you want to do that? I said, I had to give them a history lesson about folk music and binding hearts together. They said, okay, well, send us songs. We don't know what to sing. So I sent them songs. They printed out a booklet. By the time Tim went to trial, he said, the one thing I want to hear, if I can hear anything in that courtroom, is the sound of singing. Well, the judge, who was an appointee by Blazer, would not allow him to take the necessity defense, which is legal but unfair and unjust, meaning that he could tell the jury why he did this. The necessity plea, meaning the reason I did this was to prevent a greater harm. And what were the charges? Two felonies. One, he signed a paper saying he could pay for something that he couldn't, which nobody at Enron ever did. And he lost money for the government, which is absolutely untrue, because those lands have never again been put on sale, and if they were, they would bring in five times as much as they did at this Secret Service auction. He was sentenced to 2 years in jail. He's just been released. Harvard has just given him a full ride to go to Harvard Divinity. He is like the Rosa Parks of the environmental movement. Now, when at the sentencing, I was outside there, and I said to people, there comes a time when life as usual cannot continue, when you say, this has gone too far. This may be the day for you. The judge says, you're not, he's sentencing him to 2 years to provide an example. Don't do what he did. There was a time after the Kent State killings when classes were stopped across the nation. All that we had were teach-ins. And then I sang this song, and I got a call later saying, when I heard that song, I said, that did it. 26 people, including that person, got arrested protesting his sentence. Here's the song. This is not a benign thing we're doing together, folks. Singing together, you could be put in jail in South Africa for singing songs. They tried to ban Puff the Magic Dragon. They said it was about drugs. I'm not kidding you. Woody Guthrie's guitar said, this guitar kills, this machine kills fascists. Singing together is a powerful, powerful thing. It was at the March on Washington in 63. It is tonight. And you can sing when we sing, the times they are changing. Come gather around people. Wherever you roam, and admit that the waters round you have grown, and accept it that soon you'll be drenched to the bone. If your time to you is worth saving, then you better start swimming, or you'll sink like a stone. For the times, they are a-changing. Sing that. For the times, they are a-changing. Beautiful once again. For the times, they are a-changing. It's not an observation, it's a cry. Come writers and critics who prophesize with your pen, and keep your eyes wide, the chance won't come again. And don't speak too soon, for the wheel's still in the spin, and there's no telling who that it's naming. For the loser now will be later to win. For the times, they are a-changing. Do it again. For the times, come senators, congressmen, please keep a call. Don't stand in the doorway, don't block up the hall. For he that gets hurt will be he who has stalled. There's a battle outside and it's raging.
Then I'll soon shake your windows and rattle your walls, for the times, they are a changing.
Sing it to me.
For the times,
they are a changing. Our mothers and fathers throughout the land, and don't criticize what you can't understand. Your sons and your daughters are beyond your command. Your old road is rapidly aging. Please get out of the new one if you can't lend a hand. 'Cause the times, they are a changing again. 'Cause the times, they are a drawn, the curse it is cast. The slow one now will later be fast, as the present now will later be past. The order is rapidly fading, and the first one now will later be last. For the times, they are a changing. Sing it again. For the times, they are a changing.
Once more.
For the times, they are a changing.
Is a great song. It is wonderful.
It is wonderful, and it is the spontaneous, I don't know where this came from, poetry by Bob Dylan at the time. He lived with me, you know, for a while. I brought him up to my cabin in Woodstock in the summer of 1963. It was beastly hot in New York, and he came up with Susie Rotolo. And we'd go to Art Students League in the morning, and he'd stay there. We'd come back, and he'd be typing away, and he'd written, "Only a pawn in the game." And the next day, "Masters of War." You know, his own testimony said, "I don't know where those came from." Because when you do create, you are in a semi-state of non-logical, onistic personal discourse. Now, if we were to address three super important issues in today's world to try and restore the democratic process, which has been distorted and interfered with in terms of its legitimacy, what would those be, David?
I think one would be campaign finance reform to put a fence around money. I think the second would be redistricting reform. And the third would be to protect people's voting rights, which is the most important of all issues. Because you can differ with people on substantive issues. But when the government starts messing around with your right to vote, they're going to the core of the Constitution, and they have got to be stopped.
How about being able to announce that you're in the majority when you have 51% rather than 61%?
Only in the Senate.
Only.
It's why the Senate is a non-functioning body, and it will be until it changes that.
I agree. Well, we've got a political song, so now we're going to kind of cross these lines. We just did a political song, but this one is very directly so. And it's in the key of D.
What is it?
I don't know. It's Have You Been to Jail for Justice, written by Ann Feeney, who was an attorney for poverty law. And then she's also a songwriter. See, there are those people that cross those lines. And this has become a very important song. I sang this at Occupy Wall Street when it was 4 or 5 days into it. My daughter came and sang with me, and my son sang with me, and my granddaughter was there with her class. She was 4 and a half at the time. And she had her picket sign. Got to start them early. And said, we want fairness. And her classmate said, we want kindness. And the third one said, we want a bright future. Told the story right there. I also sang this up in Madison, Wisconsin. Two winters ago, to 100,000 people in the snow. And it was kind of legitimizing something that was later forbidden. You know, if you have more than three people with the instruments singing, you get busted for that. Or a piece of paper bigger than 8.5 by 11. This is democracy. So, here we go. Here's the song. It was appropriate then. Don't think these songs are anachronistic. They are relevant. Don't say, "Oh, it was such a reminiscence." It took me way back. Well, maybe so. Maybe took you forward too. Maybe that's where we got to go into this kind of gathering of hearts. Was it Cesar Chavez or Rosa Parks that day? Some say Dr. King or Gandhi that set them on their way. No matter who your mentors are, it's pretty plain to see that if you've been to jail for justice, you're in good company. Have you been to jail for justice? I wanna shake your hand, 'cause sitting in and lying down are ways to take a stand. Have you sung a song for freedom or marched a picket line? Have you been to jail for justice? Then you're a friend of mine.
You law-abiding citizens, come listen to this song. 'Cause laws were made by people, people can be wrong. Once unions were against the law, but slavery was fine. Women were denied the vote and children worked the mine. The more you study history, the less you can deny it. A rotten law stays on the books till folks with guts defy it. Have you been to jail for justice? I want to shake your hand. 'Cause sitting in and lying down awaits to take a stand. Have you sung a song for freedom? March the picket line. Have you been to jail for justice? Then you're a friend of mine. La 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 la. Well, the law's supposed to serve us, so are the police. But when the system fails, it's up to us to speak our peace. We must be ever vigilant for justice to prevail. So get courage from your convictions, let him haul you off to jail. Have you been to jail for justice? I want to shake your hand, 'cause sitting in and lying down are ways to take a stand. Have you sung a song for freedom, or marched the picket line? Have you been to jail for justice? Then you're a friend of one more. Have you been to jail for justice? I want to shake your hand. 'Cause sitting in and lying down ways to take a stand. Have you sung a song for freedom? March picket line. Have you been to jail for justice? Then you're a friend of mine. Have you been to jail for justice? Have you been to jail for justice? Have you been to jail for justice? Then you're a friend of mine. Sometimes the most eloquent voices are those raised by anonymous people who wrote folk songs many, many years ago. And when you're singing their words and singing their melodies, you don't know why, but you're in love with life. And there's something so passionate about a song like "The Water Is Wide." You're not just singing about love, you're singing about all of humanity and the aching hope for somehow, for our dreams to work out in such a way that it all makes sense and that we honor the things that are special in our lives. Rather than trivializing them or abandoning what is truly important to us. The water is wide, I cannot get off. Neither have I the wings to fly. Build me a boat that can carry two, and both shall row, my love and I. There is a ship, there is a ship. She sails the sea, she sails the sea. She's loaded deep, she's loaded deep. As deep can be, as deep can be. But not as deep, but not as deep as the love I'm in, as the love I'm in.
Do you want to know a secret?
Sure.
That's not a strong enough response. I won't tell you. I'll ask you again. I'll give you. Would you like to know a secret?
Yes.
Oh, thank you for your warm and vital, vigorous response. I'll tell you a secret. but you have to promise not to tell it to anybody. Okay? We're having more fun than you are. You know, it is such a gift to be able to do this. And I think when I was younger, it was a gift too, but I was measuring it, you know, because I wanted to know, where am I in this cosmos of whether this is going to make sense in my life? But at this point, in the same sense that it doesn't matter if you take pictures or videos or post it or whatever you're going to do, whatever happens, it's okay. It's just not to, it's not to be observed. It's not to be quantified, not to be measured, not to be evaluated. It's just to be lived. Youth is wasted on youth. Ute is wasted on ute. It, because when you're young, you're not saying, I'm young, I'm young. You don't know anything else. Love is wasted on love, because when you love, you're just in it. You're not standing back and saying, oh, let me paint this thing. Unless you have that predisposition, in which case, God bless you. We're going to turn to a serious topic. Are you okay with that?
Sure.
I'm glad to hear your response to that, because if I didn't, I would have shied away. I was coming back from a plane in Ukraine, where we are introducing a program that creates an environment of caring, loving respect, in which bullying and ridicule and ostracism and humiliation and mean-spiritedness fade away. It includes a curriculum developed by Educators for Social Responsibility, which by in itself, if you do it comprehensively, is very powerful, but it also includes music to do what? What does the music do that relates to that task? You tell me. Tell me, just say it. Brings the kids together so that they're far less likely to push their friend away like you would push her away, the one sitting next to you. Do you know her? Okay. Well, let's just look at her and say, I can't stand that color that you've got on your jacket. It's, you can't eat lunch with us. And you look at her and you say, I can tell you're the wrong religion. I'm not going to talk to you. Once you've been singing together, right? It's already done deal. And that's what kids do. And they sing this song as well as regular old folk songs. Well, I've been doing that for 15 years. This is really my most important work now. And we're in 22,000 schools across the country, and we're in countries that have called for it, like Israel, where it's translated into Hebrew and Arabic. But I'm on the way back from Ukraine. By the way, it's a free program. Any of you educated, any of you worked with children your whole life, raise your hands. I mean, come on. Any of you worked with children, raise your hand, not like this, like that. Yeah. I knew you were the smartest guy in the audience when you gave me that answer. So, you go to www.operationrespect.org. Wait a second, you're not going to remember that, I can tell. I know who you are. You can't remember anymore. Here we go. www.operationrespect.org. Sing. www.operationrespect.org. Once again. www.operationrespect.org. www.operationrespect.org. And it's free. You can download it. Or if you are in that category of people that has not yet gotten a computer, you can order it. And it'll be sent free of charge by McGraw-Hill. And it's got the curricula, grades 2 through 5, 6 through 8, music, videos that... If you, as a person working with kids, helping kids, give it a context, you will open their hearts. When you open their hearts, their minds will open too. This is the song that's the anthem of it. I'm a little boy with glasses, the one they call a geek. A little girl who never smiles, 'cause I got braces on my teeth. And I know how it feels to cry myself to sleep. I am the kid on every playground, the one that's chosen last. A single teenage mother tried to overcome my past. You don't have to be my friend, but is it too much to ask? Don't laugh at me, don't call me names, don't get your pleasure from my pain. In God's eyes, we're all the same. Someday we'll all have perfect wings. Don't laugh at me. I'm the beggar on the corner. You've passed me on the street. I wouldn't be out here begging if I had enough to eat. And don't think I don't notice that our eyes never meet. Don't laugh at me, don't call me names, don't get your pleasure from my pain. In God's eyes, we are all the same. Someday we'll all have perfect wings. Don't laugh at me. I'm fat, I'm thin, I'm short, I'm tall, I'm deaf, I'm blind. Hey, aren't we all? Don't laugh at me, don't call me names, don't be happy because I'm sitting out here at the edge of this playground and I'm crying. I've been teased, humiliated, made fun of every day on the school bus for the past 3 months. And my heart is breaking. I can't do my homework. I can't think. I can't eat. I'm frightened. I'm frightened to go to school. I'm going to join the 160,000 children a day who stay home from school because it's too painful. And I don't understand how this happened to us. I know about the Anti-Defamation League's pyramid of hate. It starts with, you're no good, you're the wrong religion, you're gay, you're ugly, you're a Jew. You're the wrong religion. Your skin color is yucky. Get away from us. And it builds to bias, prejudice, hatred, hate killing, war, genocide, the pyramid of hate. And we have to stop it now because it is growing all the time. Before these children buy into this cruelty, we have to give them the alternative. And that we can do. They are not born jumping out of the womb saying, you're a Muslim. You're an immigrant. I don't like you. Don't laugh at me. Don't call me names. Don't get your pleasure from my pain. Try singing. Don't laugh at me, don't call me names. Don't get your pleasure, don't get your pleasure from my pain, in God's eyes, we're all the same, we're all the same. Someday we'll all have perfect wings. Yes, I'm black, I'm white, and I am brown. I'm Jewish, Christian, Muslim, and Buddhist. Born in Sarajevo, born in Kosovo, born in Northern Ireland, born in Africa. I'm Hutu, I'm Tutsi, I'm gay, I'm lesbian. I am American, Indian, very, very young. I'm quite aged. Born in Iraq and Afghanistan, born in the Sudan, Mexico, Canada, United States of America. I'm Israeli, I'm Palestinian. I'm very wealthy. Very, very poor. Don't laugh at me. Please smile at me. Please be my friend. Please accept me the way I am. No one should be left out. We all should be included. Someday we'll all have perfect wings. Don't laugh at me. Don't laugh at me. One more time. Don't laugh at me. Don't call me. Don't call me name. Don't get your from my pain in God's eyes. In God's eyes, we're all the same. Someday we'll all have perfect, perfect wings. Don't laugh at me. My country, 'tis of thee, sweet land of liberty, of thee I sing. Don't laugh at me. Don't laugh at me. So I sang that song after I got the call coming home. We need you, Peter, to create a concert in Newtown. Not to raise money. There are a lot of people immediately are raising money. We need that. But we need a concert of caring and healing and togetherness. We can bring this community together to be in each other's presence and say, we love each other. We will not be defeated by this. This will not destroy us. We started working on it, and we did it on February 10th with Dar Williams, my daughter, Bethany Yarrow, Rufus Cappadocia. And the Flagpole Cafe, which is an ensemble group that does a radio show each week from Newtown, including Francine and David Wheeler, who lost their six-year-old son. You've seen Francine. She delivered the presidential address a couple of weeks ago. And I just did a show on Tuesday being interviewed with her and Bill Moyers. You'll see it tomorrow night, Saturday, Sunday, and David Wheeler, her husband. And you'll see a song she sang with Dar Williams called Family that will... It'll overwhelm you. The pain is overwhelming, but what is also overwhelming is her courage and their determination to fulfill what they call the Sandy Hook promise. And that is to be remembered not for the tragedy and the bloodshed and the killing, but as the place where the determination of a country took place to transform so that this would be prevented. And it cannot just be prevented by taking guns out of the hands of those who might do harm to children or to anybody. It's also a matter of creating that environment in which kids do not feel it's okay to harm others, and it's mandated. And then when there's a child who's going through a rough time, they isolate them. And then that child cuts themselves or takes their own life or turns on somebody after a number of years. It so happens that the shooter went to Sandy Hook and was bullied there. But guess what? If we do this, for all of our children, the next generation will be okay, because they will grow up without having to recapitulate this cycle of hate and fear. When in Africa is a tradition, two tribe members from different tribes meet, they raise their hand, and one asks the other, how are your children? The other answers, my children are well. How are your children? The other one answers, my children are well, and they pass by each other in peace. That's all we have to do, folks. That's our task. That's the Sandy Hook promise. And you're going to see that concert. That was like a march on Washington. If that concert had been seen by 40 million people, well, it may be, because it's going to be on PBS in the next 8 weeks or so, and you won't believe it. It was an historic event. So we're going to take an intermission after we sing this next depressing song. I think we need to sing Puff the Magic Dragon. Yeah. But we need all the children up here who are in the audience to come up and sing it with us. So can all the children come? Exactly. We're changing the definition of child. Anybody who's still got the moxie to enjoy the adventure of life. You, as well as chronological, under 21-year-olds, come on stage. You're 17, you are. Come on stage. Now, there is an inherent shyness in the Midwest we have to overcome. But this is friends. This is not a concert. This is just a couple of buddies sitting down and singing songs they love. And you are not an audience. And to remind you of that, we're going to bring up the lights in the audience as high as they will go right now. Here come the lights in the audience. They're coming up as high as they can. Come on around. Oh, call me Peter, for goodness sakes. Right.
Mr. Yarrow.
Uncle Peter. Okay. And just clump around David and me. David needs his clump. Now we are a real live child. Come on over here, sweetie. Come on over here. Uncle Puff the Magic Dragon appreciates you. Who bought you that beautiful headband? Who got you that? Your mom. Mom, where's mom? Her mom is here? Mom, congratulations, you've got taste. Okay. If you have a crying need to come up here and hang out with Puff's real daddy, now is your chance. Come on over here. No lines. You got a clump. We don't like lines. Standing in lines is too structured. This is an artistic. And come in. Okay, stop hugging each other. All right, here we go. What? Oh, he knocked over the water, you know. Oy vey, father. I love that. I was singing with Michael Johnson. He has this wonderful line. Michael Johnson's a great guy. He says, you remember when you used to take drugs because you wanted to? And on that note, let me reassure you that Puff the Magic Dragon was not about marijuana. It was written in 1959 when I was a senior at Cornell. Don't do the math. I'm 74, shortly 75. There was no grass on the East Coast then. Took another year or two for it to come over from North Beach. The most egregious thing we did was go on a panty raid. Or have a girl in the dorm. So I couldn't have written a song with a subtext about marijuana. I didn't have the information, the experience. I hadn't done the proper research. Years later, I could have written it many times. Just rest assured, Puff is clean. Here we go.
They would turn
perched upon gigantic tail. Noble kings and princes would bow whene'er they came. Pirate ships lower their flags, the puff word of his name. Everybody sing Puff the Magic Dragon, live by the sea and frolic in the autumn mist in a land called Halloween. Puff the Magic Dragon, live by the sea and frolic in the autumn mist in a land called
this song 50 years ago. How come you're singing it?
My brothers used to listen to it, well, still sometimes listen to it in the nighttime.
You got your CD.
You've got my back?
Got your CD.
You got my CD. Same difference. You are incredible. And your eyes, I just want to take a swim in them. Thank you, sweetheart. May I give you a wee bit of a hug, honey? Thank you. Well, I'm going to tell you a secret. I've changed the end to this song. I don't like that sad ending anymore. I don't want all those tears. If you look in the book's outside. We're going to go outside for this intermission. And you can come over there. There you go. There you go. There it is. Look at the last page. That's not the last page, but you will find it. Or next to the last page. Illustration, and you're going to see a little girl. Next to the last, not that one, the one before.
The one before? Then it's not the last page.
No, it's the next to the last page. Take a look at this. Here's Puff, and he's looking at this little girl. No, that's the one. He's looking at the, turn it to the audience, please. You had the right impulse on the wrong page. He's looking, he's saying, what are you doing in this book? What are you doing in my song? What's a little girl doing here? I don't know about that. See? So you turn to the last page, and the answer is there. The answer, my friend, is hiding on the right-hand corner. There's Jackie Paper all grown up. And now you know, it's his daughter, and that's what happened. So Puff's no longer lonely. That's the good news. The other good news is that little girls can now go to Hanalei. So that combined with the news that Puff is not about grass will fortify you for the second half of the concert. Okay, so don't get so sad. Here we go. A dragon lives forever, but not so little girls and boys. Painted wings and giant's rings make way for other toys. One gray night it happened, Jackie Paper came no more.
Puff that mighty dragon, he ceased his fears.
Humming now.
Ooh, his head was bent in sorrow. Green scales fell like rain. Puff no longer went to play along the cherry lane. Without his lifelong friend, Puff could not be brave. So Puff, that mighty dragon, sadly slipped into his cave. Keep humming, David is solo. David is solo. Together, Puff the magic lives by the sea. Frolics presidents, frolics in the autumn mist. David, now this is, that was a long first half, but it was lots of fun. And some people gave up. You know, but we never give up. So we're going to do another 20 songs.
Good night.
Okay. The songs that will be sequestered tonight. There's a song that's frequently requested that was written for me when I got married to Jean McCarthy's niece. Yeah, I married Mary Beth McCarthy. We met in the crucible of change in 1968 when Jean was running for president. It was our great hope, you know. I mean, I'm telling you, you in Wisconsin, you have some of the most amazing and some of the most hopeless I was up here campaigning. I beg your pardon?
One of each in the Senate right now.
One of each, yes. I was campaigning for Tammy. I was stuck up here during the Sandy. And I did some of those appearances with David, and we've done a number of appearances supporting candidates together. I swear, I want to get in front of Congress and play for 1 week instead of the prayer. We'll do, and not instead, it'll be the morning prayer. We'll just, David and I, we'll just sing, you know. We shall over. Hey, what do you, don't you think it's going to get better? It's not going to get worse, right? I mean, with kids growing up with that as role models, you know, it's rough and tumble. But then you've got Tammy in there, you know, and we've got some other great, great people that are going. Well, I just forgot what I was. I knew what we were going to do, and now I've forgotten. Oh, yes, the wedding song.
Okay, anybody here with their sweetie? Okay, well, here you go. It's time to hold hands or do a little group grope or whatever the heck.
What key is that?
In the key of D. The wedding song, There Is Love. So Paul, Noel Paul Stuckey, wrote this for me as to bless our wedding. And we got married in a church, which is what good Jewish boys do. And Wilmer, the McCarthy clan, are you kidding? What do you, but I didn't grow up observant. And as long as it's loving, if it's a teepee ceremony or a mass, or, you know, it's all good. My mother, however, who was born in 1903, could not abide religious observance, which is true of many immigrants from Ukraine, Jewish immigrants from Ukraine and others. So she did not bring me up as a practicing Jew. A Jew I am, yes. I'm not kidding. I'm telling you, Mr. I'm a Jew. But I'm not observant. I do observe an ethic that I think I inherit from Judaism, of which I am deeply proud. So when Noel wrote this very Christian song for my wedding, it was a wonderful thing. And many of you got married to it, right? Yeah. There Is Love. Did you get married to it? Are you married? Or are you living in sin? So here we go. But there are a couple of surprises in it. He is now to be amongst us at the calling of your hearts. Rest assured, this troubadour is acting on his part. The union of your spirits here has caused him to remain. For whenever two or more of you are gathered in his name, there is love. There is love. Sing that again. There is love. There is love. There is love. Well, a man shall leave his mother, woman leave her home, and they shall travel on to where the two shall be as one. As it was in the beginning, now until the end, a woman draws her life from man, gives it back again. There is love. Sing now. There is love, once again. There is love. There is love. There is love. And what's to be the reason for becoming husband and wife? Is it love that brings you here, or love that brings you life? And if loving is the answer, who's the giving for? Do you believe in something that you've never seen before? There is love. There is love.
there is love. There is love, there is love. She is now to be amongst us at the calling of your heart. Rest assured, this troubadour is acting on her part. The union of your spirit's fears caused her to remain. For whenever two or more of you are gathered in her name, there is love. There is love. There is love. There is love. Big blue frog. There's always the big blue frog. I'm in love with a big blue frog was written in the 1960s, a year or so before we recorded it, released an album 1700 that included the great Mandela, Leaving on a Jet Plane, I Dig Rock and Roll Music. And it's about a girl that falls in love with a blue frog. Fancy that. And she brings the frog home, and the neighbors say, hey, the property values will go down if the family next door is blue. So it was kind of a hidden, sweet way of saying it's about an African American and a white girl falling in love. Now, we've made extraordinary progress since then. We do have an African American president. But we have other blue frogs in our midst. Who is the religious blue frog, big blue frog in our country? Muslims, immigrants, gays and lesbians, although since Tammy's election it's changed, and since these marriage acts that are... All right, here it is. I'm in love with a big blue frog. A big blue frog loves me. It's not as bad as it appears. He wears glasses and he's 6'3". I'm not worried about our kids. I know they'll turn out neat. They'll be good looking cause they'll have my face. Great swimmers cause they'll have his feet. Yeah, yeah. I'm in love with the big blue frog. Say, I'm in love with the big blue. Here we go. I'm in love with the big blue frog, a big blue frog loves me. Not as bad as it appears, he's got a rhythm and a PhD. I know we can make things work, he's got good family sense. His mother was a frog from Philadelphia. is Daddy an enchanted prince? Well, I'm in the big blue crown. It's not as bad, it's not. He's got the glasses and he's 6'3". Yeah, yeah, David the Duke, Doc Duke, Duke Duke.
You gotta be kidding.
Duke 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 Saki di da kapupu, sakala bichi, a happy tappy tappa. Well, the neighbors are against it, and it's clear to me, it's probably clear to you. They say values on the property will go right down if the family next door is blue, yeah. Big frog loves me. I've got a tattoo on my chest. It spells P-H-R-O-G. It's frog to me. P-H-R-O-G-G-G. G-G-G.
Yeah.
I get tired, I get infantile. That's the way it goes. Another Bob Dylan song in the key of D. La 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 la. Well, it ain't no use in sit around and cry, babe. It don't matter anyhow. Ain't no use to sit and wonder why, babe. If you don't know by now, when the rooster he crows at the break of dawn. Look out your window, baby, and I'll be gone. You're the reason I'm traveling on. Don't think twice, it's all right. Well, it ain't no use in turning on your light, babe. The light I never know. It ain't no use to turn on your light, babe. I'm on the dark side of the road. Still I wish there was something you would do or say. Try and make me change my mind and stay. We never did do much talking anyway. I'm channeling Bob Dylan tonight. Ain't no use in calling out my name, girl. Like you never did before. It ain't no use in calling out my name, girl. I can't hear you anymore. I'm a thinking and a wondering all the way down the road. I once loved a woman, she was a child, I'm told. I gave her my heart, but you wanted my soul. Don't think twice, it's all right together now. It ain't no use sit around. It ain't no use you sit around and cry, babe. It don't matter. It don't matter anyhow. Wonder why. Ain't no use to sit and wonder why, babe. If you don't know, if you don't know by now. When the rooster he crows at the break of dawn, the catch we know, I'll be gone. Your reason I'm traveling on. Don't think twice, it's alright, David. Asked for it. We're going to do a Pete Seeger song. Yeah, that Peter, Paul, and Mary recorded on our first album. You know, Pete Seeger refused to name names in the McCarthy, not the Gene, the Joe McCarthy era. Your native son. One of the darkest periods in American political history, no doubt.
But he was a godsend. He made me a Democrat.
In A major, we're going to do Where Have All the Flowers Gone?
Oh, when will they end? Where have all the young girls gone?
I've got to say, that's one of the most beautiful renditions to hear you singing. It's like a three-part, your part and my part and David and the guitar being, boy, I'm moving to Warsaw, man. This is where it's at, man. So we're going to do our finale and then our encore, which will also serve as our second encore. It's just at the age of almost 75, it's too darn much trouble to walk to the wings and wait for you and then come back. And as far as I'm concerned, that's wasted time. I know that you're with us. I know you'd like this finale and this encore. In fact, this double encore, which is one song. So let's do our finale.
Which one is this?
The one in C, written by Bob Dylan.
How many are
Encore, right, encore. They say in Judaism, if you save one life, it's as if you've saved all of humankind, which is another way of saying that we are so deeply connected that injury to one of us or loss to one of us is lost to all of us. Tonight, a parallel statement. They say if one man stands, one human being stands to give a standing ovation, it stands for everybody and we do an encore. See again. If I had a hammer, I'd hammer in the morning, hammer in the evening, all over this land. I hammer out danger, I hammer out a warning, hammer out love between the brothers and sisters, all over this land. Well, if I had a bell, I'd sing it in the morning, sing it in the evening, all over this land. I'd sing it out of danger, sing it out of warning, love to keep your buzzing. Find a song, sing it in the morning, sing it in the evening, all over this land. Danger, warning, love between the brothers and the sisters, all over this land, land, land. Land, 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 land. Well, I got a hammer, and I got a bell, and I got a song to sing over this land. Hammer of justice, bell of freedom, song about love between brothers and the sisters. Oh, over this land, all over this land.
The Yobies, or the Oros, Obros, no, the Yobies, for the Yobies, yay!
Thank you. We're going to take a bow. Keep clapping.
Thank you.
long time passing. Where have all the flowers gone? Long time ago. Where have all the flowers gone? Young girls have picked them, everyone. When will they